Okay, thanks so much. Hey everyone, I'm John Meguerian, and today we're going to be talking about designing for code. So, tiny bit about myself before we get started. During the day, I'm a senior product designer over at Squarespace, and at work and outside of work, I also call myself an occasional front-end developer. I make a lot of side projects in code and use it to solve problems in my design work. And when I'm not making rectangles appear on screen, I'm super into cooking. I love food and wine and restaurants, interior design, sci-fi novels, and hiking, you know, especially if that hike winds up at a really great restaurant. And I wanted to start today by telling a story that I think would be super familiar to a lot of us in the design community. And that is, let's say you got really into baking sourdough over the pandemic, like a lot of us, and you wanted to share that knowledge with other people. So you put together this little learning management app where you can learn how to bake an amazing loaf of bread. So you've made these beautiful mock-ups, you've sourced your images, you did the art direction, everything's working the way you really love it, it clicks through well. And so you send it over to your development team at work. And you think, great, okay, I really did my job. And then you get a ping on Slack. Hey, you know, is the button on the course screen the same as the one on the lesson screen? I can't tell. Or, hey, should the banner have a loading state? Like, these images are pretty big. It's gonna take a long time for them to download. And then you get more messages and Jira tickets. Hey, like the padding in the lesson, does that scale proportionally when we get below a certain screen size or is it fixed? I can't tell. Or, hey, I noticed one font size is 16 pixels and one font size is 17 pixels. Is that intentional? Or, hey, should we use only the spacing tokens from the design system? Or is there something else we should do? Because I saw this value over here. And so the situation you've gotten yourself in is you're kind of in this reactionary response mode where you're fielding questions about certain parts of how this thing works and behaves in real space that people couldn't really understand from the mockups. And what's happened is that you've treated your design files as output. And at the end of the day, a design mockup isn't the final output of you or your team. Working software is software that your users can use. You know, design files are a communication tool that's used in service of creating that real thing. And so I think that design files should mirror how they will be implemented. They should look more like the code base that will eventually go and ship to users than like a representation of the app and static screens. So today, I'm going to kind of talk about why you might want to change your thinking to be more in line this way, like how to do it, a file structure that tends to work well for me, when to do it, and equally as importantly, when not to do it. And then kind of summarize and say, like, so what? What do you stand to gain by thinking this way? So we're going to start with why. And there are a couple of key benefits that you and your team can realize if you start thinking more along these lines. Design as communication, not design as output. And the first one is that you can use shared language for things. So your whole team can call one component or one element or one screen the same thing from when it's a baby on a whiteboard all the way through when it's a React component in your finished application. So if you look here, we have this lesson card from my design file about bread. And then we also have this lesson card React component and all of its children. And they're called the same things. And this is really, really helpful for communication, for discussions, for catching edge cases, et cetera, et cetera. You know, likewise, once you have a name for a thing, you also have a place for it. So with Figma, this is completely supercharged because everything lives on a URL. But your engineers, your software developers have one place to find all the details when they're implementing a piece of your feature. So here we have this little fake Jira ticket. This is implement the lesson card. And then in Figma, they can click on a URL and see all of the behaviors, all the variants, all the states, the red lines, the components that make it up, the motion guidelines, everything they need to implement that piece in code is all in one spot. And you know to return to it. And the same thing is true for other collaborators. You know, some of you that work in bigger companies that work on teams and organizations that have content strategists and design systems teams and visual designers and art directors and brand folks, lawyers even, they can all come into that same destination that has the same name and contribute all in one spot and contribute directly. The designer doesn't have to be the conduit for all this feedback and all these changes. So in the visualization, you have Chris from content strategy changing some language. You have Samira from design systems, you know, updating a color to use a different color in the scale. You have Anna, an art director, swapping out assets and trying things out, all in real time and all in one central place. And then for you, your mockups update automatically. If you start thinking this way, you realize benefits in your own process too. Like what you're looking at here, I know every designer's had this happen to them at some point in the past. You change copy in a button, right? We're gonna say watch video, not play. And then you have to find that across every single screen in your mockup and change it. But if you build up the structure in a way that mirrors how it works in software, software is really good at stuff like variables and automatic updating. So you're realizing benefits for yourself and saving yourself time in addition to unlocking benefits for the rest of your team. So we're gonna talk about how to do this. And you're probably thinking at this point, like, yeah, great, those sound awesome. Give me the file structure. I'm at Figma config. I'm in the file track. Like, show me the goods. And I will, but before I do, I wanted to make this point. And if there's one thing you walk away from after this talk, it's this, which is talk to your team. Have a conversation about this mindset. Ask your engineers how they lay out their applications. Ask your engineers what they name things. Like, talk about how you lay out your files. Talk about how you're thinking about where component boundaries are, how the thing all fits together, how it works. Because if you share your knowledge and your expertise and your way of thinking, you create a climate of trust and you create this situation where if your files don't wind up looking like my files, that's totally okay. But wherever you end up, it's gonna be a way better spot than you were if you weren't having these conversations. So I'm gonna show you one way to do it, but the most important thing is to take this mindset and have a conversation and see what works for you and your team. So the basic framework that I've found helpful when working this way basically splits your design file into three pages or major sections. There's components, views, and then a prototype. So we'll get into what each of those means and how to do it. The first is components. And these are essentially the atomic building blocks of your feature. And the general rule of thumb I use is if it's not a design system component, for those of you lucky enough to work on teams that have established design systems, if it's not a component of the design system, it should be on this page, it should be in its own frame, and it should be documented. And the way you document it is to capture its behavior and its anatomy and its variance and its states. You don't redline, right? This isn't redlining in the traditional sense where you say, this is 24 pixels from that, or this is 2/3 of that. What you really want to capture is the stuff you can't measure in the design tool, like there's a flexible space here, or you should use the text subtitle component out of the design system for this, or when you hover, this transitions and it's this easing curve and it should take this much time, or there's a hover state, there's a focus state, there's an active state, it comes in rounded or in square, right? So you're really using this page to capture all of those things that you might need to know to then go wire this up in code, right? You should be able to sit right here and do all the work you need to do to make that atomic unit complete in the code base. And you might notice on this slide that there is actually a little bit of CSS code on the page. And if you don't know it, that's totally okay. This is why you have open dialogue with your engineers. But the point is to try to specify as much as possible how this thing behaves rather than its exact distances, because Figma does that for you. So again, do capture variance, states, anatomy, behavior of the component, but don't redline what you can already measure using Figma. And then you take those components and you construct your views. So what you're looking at here is every discrete screen in this feature. And it's using real content. And if you notice in the layer list over here, it's using almost entirely these purple component instances. So what you do is using all those components you've made and documented, you stitch together every major screen in your feature or your application. And this is when you want to bring in your content partners and your art directors and your visual designers and your photographers and everyone who's going to collaborate on making the content real. They come in at this level. And so what you do is you frame out every screen, build it with the components, and put in the real content and make those main components as well. So you're now like kind of two layers of component in. And the beauty of this approach at this stage is if you can't make a certain screen, a certain view, it works as sort of like a check on yourself, right? So you know that you need to go back and make a component that maybe you overlooked or maybe split something into two because there's a variation of it you needed. And you're doing this at the level of the design before we've invested time and cycles as a whole team kind of making architecture choices and making commits and code. So it's a really nice self-reinforcing way to make sure your design is complete at this phase. So use your components from your components page to make this. That's a huge part of it. Absolutely use real content. This is a great place to raise a flag and say, hey, I don't have the copy for this, or I don't know what this is gonna say. And remember things like empty states, setting screens, et cetera, right? This is the chance to really go complete and make sure you have everything covered. But what you're not doing here is like putting mock-ups in device frames or making like 30 duplicate screens to capture hovers and focus and stuff like that. You already documented that on your components page because they're going to be built in a much richer, more expressive medium, which is actually code. And then finally, once you've done all this, you get to your prototype. And the top line here is that this should be really, really easy at this point. You've already done all the hard work, making your components, capturing their variants, making all your views, putting in the content. So really what you're doing here is just grabbing those view components out of your file and stitching them together into the happy path. And any things you're interested in for a user test or things you want to show off for a stakeholder review, right? So this is where you kind of put it all together. If you're working on a feature inside of a larger application, this is where you add the context of your main application Chrome and show where this feature's existing inside of your app. But the high level is that this is the outcome of all the work you've done before, not the bulk of your time as a designer. So the do's here are make this out of your views and make all the happy paths kind of reachable with prototyping noodles, but don't prototype every hover, click, or error. You captured that already in the components, right? Because those behaviors are encoded at the component level in the real application, not at the screen level, like in a design file. And some of the features that Figma shipped recently, like interactive components and component variants, make this incredibly easy and incredibly powerful because you'll get the interactivity and the rich, expressive interactions in this prototype with no additional work on your behalf. So in summary, build all your components, make sure they're well specified, build views out of those components and all the real content you're going to use. And then at the end, you're going to create a prototype that's self-updating and richly interactive, very little work. And you use that to show off and get feedback from users and stakeholders. So at this point, you know, I've talked about this before with people, and a lot of designers at this point are like, John, this is so much work. Like, it's really restrictive. This is like this framework is like really boxing me in. Like, how am I supposed to explore? And that brings me to when to do this and when not to do this. And the short answer is don't do this for explorations. Right? Like, I'm not suggesting that to get an idea from your brain onto paper, you need to think in this sort of like richly architected, like, you know, design to code mirroring thing. No, like your exploration should be pen and paper. It should be in FigJam. It should be, you know, on a whiteboard with your colleagues, hopefully soon when we get back to the office. This is about documentation and getting ready for production. It's about delivery, right? Because your design file is a communication tool. So you're communicating with yourself when you're exploring. You know, sometimes if it's like a quick thing, an existing pattern where you just needed to kind of specify how the screens go together, maybe you don't need to go this hard. But for new features, for generative stuff, where no one's seen anything like this before, you should always take the time. Once you've got your explorations in and know what you're going to do, you should always take the time to document your designs and make sure they communicate as much as possible to the rest of your team. So what does this all mean, right? Like, why should I care? What benefits do I gain from this? And I had to do this. There's this gem and it comes up all the time. And you might be thinking at this point, like, this is a lot of work and it takes a certain mindset to know how to do this, right? Like, wouldn't it be better if the designer could just make the components themselves? Like, should designers code? And whether or not you have an opinion on that, like, what I would suggest is reframing this question as, should we understand the tools we're using on a team? Should software engineers and content strategists and everyone else understand the limits and the strengths of design tooling? Should designers understand how their designs are being implemented and the limits and strengths of the application frameworks we use and actually ship to our users every day, right? Again, if there's one thing that you take away from this talk, it's have a conversation with your team about all this. Like, share your knowledge about design. Have them share their knowledge about architecting React applications or, you know, how they think about component boundaries versus you. Like, build trust with each other and with your mental models and how you're thinking. Because if you do, you wind up in this universe where everything is so, like, takes so little overhead to think about and reason about and change. So you're getting to a point where the same layer name in Figma is the same component in React. That's the same thing in the Jira ticket. That's the same thing in the copy doc. And you're living in this world where it takes fewer mental cycles to really understand what you're talking about and what's happening. You can move faster and ship things faster, and you're going to be more correct, right? Like, there's this notion that if it's in your design file, it's this infallible truth. Like, it's supposed to be 17 pixels instead of 16, right? But really, that's a bug, right? You made a mistake and it probably should have been on your spacing scale of 16, right? So if you can get to this level of dialogue in your team and everyone kind of trusts that they're on the same wavelength and thinking the same way, you can kind of feel confident that people will all realize that, or people won't, you know, feel bad about hitting you up and saying, hey, John, like, this is supposed to be 16, not 17, right? So this is a really powerful place to be. And whether or not you implement this exact framework or something else, having the conversation and having the mindset is going to, like, really, really benefit you, your team, your organization. So the thing I'll leave you with is, you know, for those of us in the room who are designers, we pride ourselves on being really user-centric and really having a process where we interrogate, you know, the goals and needs and pain points of the people we're designing for. And what I would suggest is to apply that same rigor to your design process, right? You're creating these communications, these tools to convey your vision to others. And I would suggest putting the same amount of rigor and critical thinking into how you're doing that as you're putting into the actual features you're designing for your end users of your company. So really, if we take a second, if we talk to our teams, if we build shared knowledge and trust, if we think about design as communication and think about design as an analog of working software, we can really design our design process, and that really benefits everyone in the long run. So thanks so much for listening. I put my Twitter handle on here. I'm JMegs. I love talking about this stuff. It's a huge passion of mine. So if you do try this out, or if you have thoughts or questions, like, please hit me up. I'd love to have a conversation about it. And thank you again for listening. Have a great config.